Plants transport water over long distances, typically from the roots to the leaves, where water evaporates by solar energy. The transport process inside the plant mainly occurs in the so-called silent tissue. Under most conditions, silent sap is transported under negative pressure. Important phenomena that contribute to the negative pressure include transpiration, capillarity, and resistance. Transpiration creates a sucking force on the silent sap because evaporating water is replaced by liquid water. At the same time, capillary forces in the tiny leaf veins and the openings of cell walls can be considerably high. Since the transport system between the roots and leaves does not consist of a completely open tube without barriers, the continuous water column experiences hydraulic resistance during its way upstream. The resistance of water that is caused by the tiny diameter of the tubes in the many porous cell walls that water molecules have to cross plays a major role in tensile water transport. Since silent sap is typically saturated with gas, it remains poorly understood why gas is not coming out of solution when the sap is under negative pressure. Indeed, the formation of gas bubbles could fill up the transporting cells and interrupt the transport system. We know that hydraulic failure, which we call embolism, may occur during periods of drought stress or after freeze-thaw events. While plants transport silent sap on a daily basis without seemingly major problem under normal growing conditions, prototypes of artificial systems nearly always fail due to embolism. So how do plants transport water under negative pressure? Negative pressure means that tension is applied to silent sap, which can sustain these forces because of hydrogen bonds between water molecules. This means that silent sap in the tree does not spontaneously become water vapor, but there is a risk for air entry by large bubbles. Under normal growing conditions, the negative pressure is not too negative, and this is not problematic for many plant species, but air entry may occur under drought. Knowing which amount of drought stress induces hydraulic failure is an important ecological question because it allows us to predict the transport capacity of plants under climate change conditions. Therefore, plant scientists have developed various methods to quantify resistance of the silent to hydraulic failure. One of these methods is a modified centrifuge.
It is very difficult to measure flow under negative pressure in an intact plant. As soon as we cut open this small branch, we will have air quickly entering the cut open end, and therefore locally here we have no longer negative pressure. When we spin this short stem segment in our centrifuge, we are able to measure the flow through the sample while the sample is subject to negative pressure due to centrifugal forces.
By measuring the hydraulic conductivity of samples at increasing speed levels, which correspond to increasing levels of negative pressure, we can estimate when exactly the transport system in the sample fails. The species that are adapted to dry environments show typically a higher absolute resistance to embolism than species from wet environments. So our centrifuge experiments provide a useful tool to test the water transport capacity of many plant species under increasing levels of drought stress. At the same time, our centrifuge offers a highly repetitive method to investigate how exactly plants are able to transport water under negative pressure without the constant occurrence of hydraulic failure. Although water transport in plants has been studied for centuries, our mechanistic understanding of it remains incomplete. Therefore, how exactly plants transport water under negative pressure remains one of the long-standing questions in biology.